Hey, welcome to another reading vlog. And this week it's a long weekend reading vlog because we have Vesak Day today, and then it leads up into the weekend. So Vesak Day is for our Hindus to celebrate holiday, and so thank God for me, I have also a holiday thanks to them. Thank you very much. And in this vlog, I'll be reading one of the books that I've wanted to read for a really, really long time, which is The Grace of Kings. I bought this book years and years ago when I found out about it on BookTube, and I've wanted to read this all this time because it sounded so intriguing to me, and that I didn't know, like, I knew that this is the kind of fantasy that I'll be really, really into. And I think I was so intrigued by this when the Poppy War first came out. Well, this one already came out like a long time back compared to the Poppy War, but when I read the Poppy War, I heard about this and wanted to read this. So you can imagine it was quite a long time ago. And so I'm finally reading this for my SFF tackle down, and I'm very, very excited and thankful and greatly appreciative that I'm finally reading this in the month of June, I guess. Yeah, I'm reading this now. Okay, so I don't actually know what this is about, but it's supposedly set in China. Yeah, and I'll probably keep you guys updated and really talk about this later on because I truly don't know what this is about. Yeah, I'm so sorry. I'm doing a really bad job. But it's a debut novel by Hugo Nebula and World Fantasy Award winner Ken Liu. All right, keep you guys updated when I can. Good morning, and I look deathly pale. Oh gosh, I'm kind of feeling tired. I didn't sleep late, but I felt like I didn't get a good rest, if you know what I mean. I woke up with a headache, so I'm kind of tired, but all is well. I would like to give you some updates. Over the weekend, from Friday until Saturday, I've been doing really good with my reading, which I'm super happy about. Yeah, I'm super happy about. I'm currently at the 200 page mark for The Grace of Kings, but additionally, because I haven't finished the other reads that I was reading, which is AKA Dune and Ninth Rain, I finally finished them over the weekend. So that was great. I mean, today's Sunday, so I'm really proud of the progress so far. So I'm very, very happy that I'm where I am right now, and I read like 200 pages over the course of 2 days, which is very unlike me. As you know, I'm very slow with my reading, And so that's why I'm quite surprised. But that being said, let's talk about the Grace of Kings. The joke is that I still don't know what's going on. I still don't know what is the exact plot of the story, but it just seems like we're following almost like a historical encounter of various characters in the course of history in a steampunk China. So we're seeing how people rise to power. We're seeing how they are, you know, stripped from their power. We're seeing the course of history in China, and we're seeing how they're progressing with that. And I'm surprised I'm loving it this much, because I think theoretically I'm not someone who really enjoys reading about a story following multiple characters without going too deeply into another character. Like, I really enjoy character studies. I really enjoy character studies. So therefore, this is a bit of a interesting one where I'm really into the whole idea of following multiple characters over the course of time and seeing how everyone's role in the play out of events is occurring. And that's what's very enjoyable for me. I'm actually flying through it because I think Ken Liu's writing is so easy to grasp. He's just telling you face value what's happening, but not in a way that, like, you know, he's telling you like this happened to this person. It's like this person goes to that place and then this thing happened, but he's not like describing how they look like. He's not describing how the world looks like. And it's like just very face value. Like, you just accept what it is for what it is. It's like, I don't really know how most of our characters look except for one female character that we're being introduced to so far. I did recall that I saw a lot of complaints about the fact that The Grace of Kings doesn't have much female characters, but yeah, we don't, and they always say like it's a little bit misogynistic, like how the female characters are portrayed, but so far with the only female character that we have seen so far, other than like a side character, I thought she's pretty good. Like, I thought she's pretty awesome, and she's super independent, she's so reliable, and she's so brave, and you know, what a great female character. Genuinely, that's why I was confused as to what is the problem here, but I guess 200 pages in, I have not met any other character that is a female other than her, but I think it's alright considering the time period that we're talking about, which is like steampunk China in the, I don't know which era this is, but in the medieval China, you could say. So women's roles in that time is usually quite minute. I mean, at least based on China history that I've ever encountered, we don't really talk about the women inside involved. It's usually the men in power, so I mean, that makes sense, unless you're talking about like the royal family. Yeah. So I'm enjoying the progress of the story because of how it's being structured, which is that we're following multiple characters at one go, and each chapter is like a different character most of the time, and sometimes we jump back to our main characters. We have two main characters, which is like Kuni and Mada, and they're supposed to be the main driving force of the story, but clearly we are focusing on a lot of other people that are surrounding them and creating the course of history that we are to see. And so that's why we're following a lot of people, and it can be confusing for a lot of people, but for me it's just like accepting the information, like history, like they're telling me that this is the historical events of this particular steampunk fictional China, and just accepting the information being thrown at my face, you know. And so I am enjoying very much where I am right now with the story, and I am at a good place where things are happening, and things are happening all the time, because currently we're in the midst of a rebellion, and people are going against the emperor because he's freaking useless. He's just a child, so I don't blame him. It's all the people around him that's manipulating him, which is very normal for that time period where we have child emperors and then the advisors manipulate them to their bidding, and that was horrible. And so essentially, we are here where we are at, and there are like a bunch of rebellious people who are trying to get back China to where it was again, because right now, it's not China, okay? It's a fictional China, but it's not called China. Anyway, so right now, we started the story with this fictional China being united as one country, which if you know China's history, that was always the case. It happened in the Qing dynasty, where Qin Shi Huang has united the entire of China to follow his one language and to completely unify where we're not being ruled by multiple emperors over different states and that there's just one emperor with his dukes. So that's Qin Shi Huang's rule, and he was very notoriously like horrible, which is exactly what this emperor is before this Chao emperor that we have right now. So it's like I understand the context of everything, but also because I have learned a bit of China's history very minutely, and I remember some of the information, and that's how it is so far. And so I'm really, really enjoying the progress of everything. Strangely enough, it seems that I like to be taking a step back and looking at all these events happening at one go and seeing how they're progressing in history and how it's affecting each other. And I love that. I love that whole aspect. I don't really know why, but here I am. Here I am enjoying the book so much. And strangely enough, even though we are not focusing so in-depthly with characters, in some senses, we are not really focusing so much on them that we are still getting very intimate moments in their mind and how they feel. And that really draws a lot of, like, we are seeing their history within the chapter, like their backstory. And it makes you feel very, very much for the character. And to be frank, I have to warn you guys, don't go into The Grace of Kings thinking that you're going to get attached to any character. Don't attach yourself to anyone, because anybody could just die in a moment. Ken Liu is malicious. Like, he doesn't give a shit. He just kills whoever he wants to kill. And then he will just make you suffer the consequences of, like, hey, but I like that guy. Why should you take him away? Yeah, so that's me. I like the character that was only introduced in one chapter, and then he died in the same chapter he was introduced in. I was like, okay, way to play with my feelings, Mr. Ken Liu. I got played. So I know that he's ruthless. He just kills characters left and right. Even if they feel like they're central to the story, their roles are time limited. Meaning that they show their importance for only a select time period. But we have to move on. The story continues and life continues despite their death. I actually love that. Yeah. I don't know if I'm explaining very coherently, but that's what I have of The Grace of Kings so far. And the reason why I feel that it's written for someone like me is that I really enjoy China's history. I really enjoy that history of that time period and how everything comes together. And so I have some background knowledge, and so it's helping me to feel through the book without getting too extremely confused. Not that he's using real characters from history, but it's like I understand how, like, the tactics are. I understand their battle tactics. I understand their politics in that some senses, and how it's not foreign to me as a concept. And so I'm not trying to grasp it as a foreign concept. It's a concept that I really understand, and I'm just taking it in. So that is the update, actually. The last I updated you, it was a little bit abrupt. But it was because I had to leave to go watch a movie, which is the new Spiderverse movie, Into the Multiverse. Oh my. Can I take a moment to just talk about this goddamn movie, which is so good? No one was lying. Everybody was right about it. And that it was an excellent movie in terms of storyline, in terms of animation, in terms of everything, music, I don't know. It's just the whole thing felt insanely emotional, which is correct for Spider-Man's, like, progress in story. And in general, the animation, like, truly the animation was a next level, God-given.
Talented, brilliant, incredible, amazing, show-stopping, spectacular, never the same.
Beauty, I don't know what else to say, but seriously, watch the first one and also watch the second one, which is just out in this week. Please do go watch it. It's really a masterpiece. It's unlike anything I've ever seen, because when we talk about animated movies, this is revolutionary. Truly, Spider-Verse is revolutionary. I am not taking those words back. I'm not exaggerating, but seriously, think about it. Go watch it. Because I encourage everyone. It is emotional, but it's humorous, and it's family-friendly, but also, you know, has some sadness to it as per Peter Parker's storyline, you know? as per a Spider-Man storyline. It's a little bit sad, but also very funny. So yeah, and so that's what I did. And for the whole day, essentially, I've been out and about. And as you can see, I went to the bookstore, which is very fun for me. I love that. And I bought two books. I bought, finally, my bookstore decided to stock this, which is Engines of Empire. And I was like, thank God, you guys finally decided to stock this one. And I bought that straight away because they don't keep, like, they only had like two books on the shelf. And that was like the first time I've seen it since the three or four visits that I made to the bookstore like this year. And so I bought that, and I bought the sequel to Dune. Surprising for me, I just finished Dune, but I'm just like, I heard that you kind of have to read the second Dune in order to really see whether it's worth carrying on with the series. But Dune Messiah will give you a better overview as to whether it's something that you want to continue on or not. And so I did that too. And I have, and so because of running around and essentially spending time with my loved ones, my family and my partner together, I haven't had any time to read today. And so I'm not too upset because I did make pretty good progress, considering how I'm quite a slow reader. And I'm very happy the progress I made. I finally finished two of the books that I read, and I also am about 200 pages into The Grace of Kings, and I'm still continuing on with The Lord of the Rings for a different vlog. I'm happy with my progress. And in other things that are happening in my life, as you know, I've always been talking about school and how I'm so busy with it recently, and I'm glad to say that I'm almost at the very end. So the very last presentation will be on Monday. And after that, I will be free for the entire month of June, which is, I do feel a little bit better about it. Like, I feel relieved. Yeah, I feel really relieved because I'm like, okay, finally done with school. I can focus on making good videos. But not that I'm not focusing, but it's a lot harder for me to find a motivation to especially edit. It's not so much about the filming. Sometimes I can film, but when it comes to the editing, I get a little bit like unmotivated is the key word. Yeah, unmotivated because I just want to do things that I really want to do, like read. And then when I don't even really have time to read, so I'll be like, ah, oh, do I really have to edit? I'd rather like spend the time to read, which a good thing because I'm prioritizing the things that I love. I mean, not that I don't love making videos. If not, I would have stopped. But the first thing and the only reason why this channel exists is because of reading. So I have to continue on the hobby that I love, and I have to feel motivated to read, which I still am, which I'm glad about despite feeling tired and always not having enough energy. Okay, I'm not someone who's a night owl. I don't stay up late. I can't stay up late. If I stay up late, I'm a zombie, and the next day when I wake up for work early in the morning, I'll be a zombie. I won't feel very great. So I never ever actually read into the night because of that reason, and because I know myself, so I don't do that for my health sake and for my own mental health sake, I guess. Yeah, but that's all I wanted to update you in terms of life and in terms of what I bought from the bookstore too. And to obviously recommend all of you to go and watch Spiderverse. If you haven't catched the first one, go watch that one. And then the second one, which I actually don't know what's the actual title except for it's called Spiderverse. And then the subsidiary title that is like number two. I don't know what it's called. Spiderverse 2. Just go watch all of them. It's so good. It will not disappoint. It has everything. It is not just like those superhero movies. I think it holds a lot of depth. Spider-Man always has a lot of depth with his storytelling, and especially with this particular one. And the previous one too. So I highly encourage all of you to watch it. And otherwise, I will keep you guys updated again. I know this is a weekend reading vlog, but I would like to end the vlog on a different day. And then tell you about the progress that I've made. Okay. Keep you guys updated. See ya.
Guess who's the fool for forgetting to actually end this vlog? I forgot to end the vlog, and I you know, was editing everything. I was like, where is the end to this vlog? Girl, you forgot to film it, okay? So, you know, at this point, I already finished The Grace of Kings. Yeah. Freaking chef's kiss, everybody. It's so good. So good. Go and read it, because doing yourself a disfavor for not doing it. And you know what? I'm giving it 5 out of 5 stars. But you guys will get a proper review from me, okay? You guys will get a proper review from me. I will be posting it maybe in August. And yeah, so look forward to it. And then I'll talk about it then. But otherwise, I recall in the vlog that I was only reading The Grace of Kings. And I finished also Dune and Ninth Rain the last time around. And wow, great, great, great. 3 books done with this vlog, because obviously this vlog is like overextended. But I really did enjoy The Grace. Let me just talk about it properly now, since I really know what happens and whatsoever. So what I said the last time was right. We are following two main characters called Kuni and Mata. And the two of them are the main leading forces of this revolution for this country. And so the whole plot is essentially about a revolution, a grand tale of moving parts between different warring states in this fictional China, and how different groups of power are rising and falling during this time period of couple of like 20 to 30 years. And so we see the course of history happening and unfolding before our eyes, with the two of them being the main center of the plot. We see their friendship get better, wane, you know, get better and wane, and how the effects of war has on people and the people around them and whatsoever. And I think it was brilliant in so many ways, and the writing was so easy to get through. Ken Liu really didn't do a lot of descriptive work, which I think benefits for his kind of storytelling, where it's, if he's not describing every single chair that's in the room, it's much easier to just pull through and get the really main points and themes of the entire story. And so it was wonderful, and despite it being a character-driven plot that is spanning across a huge span of time, I don't feel like I don't know our characters. Like, other than Kuni and Mata, who we are following from the start to the finish, we get a lot of perspectives from many, many, many major characters in the story that push the plot forward. And I felt like I understood them so well. I really understood where they're coming from. And despite not seeing them on page all the time, I felt for their backstory. I felt for them as characters. I truly treasured them as people, even when they're making the worst mistakes, even when they are supposedly the bad ones or the good ones. They're just morally gray characters, and they're just so realistic, and they feel real. Okay, I'm getting a little bit agitated. And so my point is, I enjoyed The Grace of Kings greatly and would like you guys to read it. And it's really, really time to end the vlog here. So thank you so much for watching, and I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you will read The Grace of Kings, even though I didn't talk so explicitly about it. And I hope you also catch the first Spiderverse movie and the second Spiderverse movie, because those were excellent and you will not regret. In fact, you'll be thanking me probably. So yeah. So don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. And I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye!